Hi everyone, I'm Chrissy B, host of the UK's only TV programme that's dedicated to your mental health, well-being and success, The Chrissy B Show. Now, do you get enough vitamins? And did you know that they play a vital role in bodily functions such as metabolism, immunity and digestion? And without them, we could even die. Well, we thought it was about time we took vitamins seriously, so today I'm going to be joined by Dr. Sarah Jarvis, who'll be discussing how important vitamin D is for both our physical and mental health. We'll be joined by our second doctor, Rob Hicks, who'll be answering all of your medical questions. Then we'll be catching up on how celebrities have been helping others with Helena Chard in Behind the Fame. Then at the end of the show, I'll be talking to the director of Ekko Cleaning Service, Dilyana, Asenova, for handy hints and tips to clean your home. And I'll be giving you my top 5 ways to declutter your mind. Now, an increasing amount of research links dietary choices to brain health and the risk of psychiatric illness. According to the Mental Health Foundation, nearly 2/3 of those who do not report daily mental health problems eat fresh fruit or fruit juice every day. Those who report some level of mental health problems also eat fewer healthy foods. So clearly, an issue that many of us face these days is that we are overfed, but also often undernourished. But it can be so difficult to know which vitamins help with what, can't it? Well, here's a guide. A lack of vitamin C can lead to tiredness, sore muscles, and bleeding gums. If you're low on vitamin D, as we'll hear from Sarah later, you can end up with weak or deformed bones. Not enough vitamin E can cause a destruction of vital red blood cells, which can lead to anemia and fatigue, and deficiencies in other vitamins such as folic acid and B12 can also help cause depression. So often we might not realize we are short in vitamins, but our mood and behavior suggests otherwise. Well, let's hear what some of you think about it. Hillary actually doesn't believe vitamins benefit her skin. She says, "I was trying to be good to my body and take vitamins, but they made my face break out horribly, so lesson learned." Leonardo says, "Health tips, saturated fats are good for you. You need them to carry key vitamins, just not hydrolyzed or trans fats." Simplify Health Fitness say, "Wheatgrass shot kind of day. Wheatgrass shots are a good way for you to get a lot of your vitamins in one shot." Vicky gives her top tip, which is, if you're feeling depressed but aren't happy taking meds, try taking your vitamins. Diana says, vitamins play a huge preventative role in illness and curing even leading causes of death. Niacin even aids in mental health too. And Emily reminds us to always look after ourselves first, saying, reminder that if you've found medicines, vitamins, routines, activities, etc. that help your mental health, it's not selfish to take or do them. So thank you very much for those comments. Now, we do love to hear from you guys at home about what you think about our shows, and I just wanted to share this viewer's comment with you from our One Punch and You're Dead episode, where we interviewed the uncle of a young man who died from a single punch. What his family didn't know was that he had signed an organ donor form and went on to save many lives after his death. So here's the comment. Brilliant interview, which must have been so hard to do, but what an impact Connor has had on so many people, whether young or old. The letter he wrote when he was going skiing brought tears to my eyes. The recipient of the liver donation also brought tears. What a lovely young man and what a fantastic family to be doing what they are doing. Connor just goes on and on. Rest in peace, young man. So thank you so much for that comment. And if you would like to send in your comments, maybe you've watched the show on YouTube or watched it here on TV, or maybe you've seen the show somewhere and you'd like to give us your comments, or you'd like to tell us about ideas that you have for the show. Maybe there's something that you'd like to see covered here. Do email us on info@chrissybshow.tv. But now back to today's topic. Vitamin D has been in the news a lot recently, all because the government published new guidelines advising everyone to make sure they're consuming at least 10 micrograms of vitamin D every day. But why is this? And how important is it for our physical and mental health? Well, here to answer those questions for us is Dr. Sarah Jarvis. Welcome to the show, Sarah.
Thank you. Very good to be here.
So there's a reason why we have these lovely flowers on the table.
There is. Yeah, they're the sunflowers, and we're talking about the sunshine.
I absolutely love them. So you're here to tell us all about vitamin D, aren't
yes.
you?
Yes.
And why we need it so much.
I am.
Tell us all about it.
Well, vitamin D actually is a really odd one because it's the only vitamin that you just can't get enough of, no matter how balanced your diet is.
Okay.
And we call it the sunshine vitamin, mm-hmm. sunflowers, hence, because 90% or so of the vitamin D we have in our bodies, we make in our own bodies, in our skin, when sunshine falls on our skin. Now, it may not feel like it at the moment, but we do occasionally get sunshine in the UK. And between about April and October, some people, quite a lot of people, can get enough vitamin D without putting themselves at risk from burning. And of course, that's really important because in recent years, we've had all these messages about terribly important to avoid sun damage to your skin, increased risk of cancer and so on. And I think probably what's happened is the pendulum has swung a little bit too far.
Much the other way.
Yeah, people are so careful that they don't think that they do need some sunshine in order to get vitamin D.
Okay. And how much, how long should you be staying out in the sun so you can get that, that dose?
Oh, how long is a piece of string? The problem is it very much depends on who you are. Okay. So if, like me, I like to describe myself as an English rose.
Yes.
In other words, pale
indeed.
And pasty. Then actually, you probably absorb vitamin D very well through your skin, but it doesn't take very much to burn you. If at the opposite end of the spectrum, people who are of Afro-Caribbean origin, people of South Asian origin, they don't make vitamin D as well in their skin, so they need to spend longer. But as a kind of very, very general rule of thumb, we would say 15 to 20 minutes between 11 and 3 in the UK, clearly not in brilliant sunshine in the Mediterranean or near the equator, but 15 to 20 minutes in full sunshine with arms and face uncovered and no sunscreen just for that, but not enough to burn.
Okay. Good to know. So, I don't take vitamin D supplements.
You should.
I was going to say, see, look, and I'm pretty sure that after this interview with you, I will be taking them. But can you tell us actually what happens to us if we are vitamin D deficient?
I can. And when I say you should, that's not me, that's the chief medical officer saying that actually everybody should now be taking 10 micrograms a day from October to April. If they live in the UK, and if you're at high risk, and I think we'll probably go on to that in a minute, then you should be taking that all year round.
Okay.
If you don't, the big one that we all know about, I think, is thinning of the bones, because we know calcium's really important for bone health, but actually you can't absorb calcium into your bones properly, you can't metabolise it properly unless you have vitamin D. So as an adult, you're more prone to a condition called osteoporosis, or thinning of the bones, and we know that one in three people at the age of 50, if they're a woman, is going to break a hip or another bone because of osteoporosis before they die. And if you're a man, that figure is one in five. So actually a really, really high risk. We do need to protect our bones and we need to start very, very young.
Okay.
Children can get rickets, which when I was a girl, when I was a medical student, we thought was a thing of the Victorian days. They're back. I've seen patients, kids with rickets, and it's really scary.
Wow.
But actually, there's so much more, because vitamin D is incredibly complicated. It regulates loads of our genes, the genes in our body that help our immune system to function, that affect our mood, that affect our muscle strength, all sorts of things. So, for instance, pregnant women, we know if you are low in vitamin D, you've got a higher risk of getting gestational diabetes, diabetes of pregnancy.
Wow.
Your child may be at higher risk of asthma. If when your child's born, they haven't got enough vitamin D, they're likely to be at higher risk of asthma. We may find, I know, as you get older, that you're at increased risk of depression. There's a possibility that actually it may even be linked to things like multiple sclerosis, heart disease, and cancer. We know that people, for instance, in the north of Scotland, in the Outer Hebrides, are at much higher risk of multiple sclerosis. And we know that if we give people with MS vitamin D, they have fewer relapses.
Wow.
So it's incredible how many bits of the body it affects.
You just don't hear much about it, though, do you?
That's why I'm here to do something about it.
Yes, that is why we're talking about it on this programme. Now, Sarah, in terms of which vitamins to take, because there are so many out there, and sometimes I'm terrible at taking vitamins. I start taking them the first few days, and then I just don't seem to take them anymore. But I will do it this time. I will do it properly. How can you choose a good one for you that you know actually is has got the stuff and it's not full of bulking agents and all this other rubbish that are put into vitamins?
That's actually a really important question where vitamin D is concerned. The majority of vitamins actually you really don't need if you've got a healthy, balanced diet. And what worries me about a lot of vitamins is that if you're popping the vitamin tablets as a kind of insurance policy, you're popping them in case you don't have a good diet. So you feel you don't need a good diet. I'd much rather you weren't taking the vitamin tablets and were having a really healthy, balanced diet. But as I've said, you can't get it in case of vitamin D. So what I would look for instance, the one I prescribe is one called Fultium. And that's because we know that it's manufactured to the same standard as other drugs. It's very, very carefully regulated. And that is now available from your pharmacist as Fultium Daily D3. So we know that the dose you get in that, which is 10 micrograms, which is what the Chief Medical Officer recommends, is exactly what you're going to get.
And that's just one a day then?
It's just one a day. Okay. What we have seen with some of the others, there are lots of others out there, but we do know that with some of the others that aren't so carefully regulated, you don't know how much you're getting, and the amount can vary quite widely.
Okay then. And actually, we're going to put that, the one that you're talking about, we'll put that on our website. So if you'd like to go to chrissybshow.tv, you'll find more details there. And everyone should be taking these supplements?
Everybody should be taking them. Yep. So everyone should be taking them in winter.
Yeah.
But if you're at risk of vitamin D, particular risk of vitamin D, because we're all at risk of vitamin D deficiency, then you should be taking it all year round. So what we're talking about there is babies under 1 year should take 8.5 micrograms rather than 10. Unless they're having more than 500 mils of formula milk a day, because that's supplemented with vitamin D.
Right.
Once you're from 1 to 4, you should be taking 10 micrograms every day. The other end of the life spectrum, if you're over 65, you should be taking it.
Yeah.
If you're housebound, if you cover up for religious reasons, and probably dark-skinned people.
Okay.
And I have to say, this isn't in the guidelines, but from my perspective, when I actually tested my own vitamin D about 7 years ago now, when I first started hearing about it, deficient is less than 30.
Okay.
So if you're, you know, that's really, really not enough. So under 50 is not enough. Under 30 is really not enough.
Okay.
I'm so careful about getting burnt. My level was 12.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's why I'm a bit of an evangelist about it.
And Sarah, when you do start taking these supplements, how quickly can you see results in the way you feel about yourself?
Okay, so one of the things about vitamin D, I've already mentioned lots of things that can increase your risk of. You won't know you've got any of those, but we do know that, for instance, in older people, there are bigger risk of falls, and their muscles can be less strong if they're low in vitamin D. We also know if your vitamin D levels are very, very low, then you can get severe muscle aches and pains. Now, if you're very low in vitamin D, then actually within a few weeks, certainly within a couple of months, you should start to see those symptoms go.
Wow.
But one of the things to remember about most people taking vitamin D is you won't know you've got osteoporosis until you trip over in the street and break a bone.
So prevention is better, right?
Better
than you. Sarah, thank you so, so much. It's been really enlightening. And I will be taking my vitamin D supplements.
Very
thank
glad
you. And
to
I'm
hear
sure
it.
Our viewers are going to go out there and do the same.
Thank
you so much.
To check up on you.
Yes, I'll let you know the results anyway. Now I've got to do it. Well, everyone, as well as taking your vitamin D supplements, if you'd like to top that up with your food, here's a lovely recipe with Danielle Shine.
Hi, everybody. Did you know you can make milk from nuts? Not only does nut milk taste delicious, but it's a much better choice of a dairy milk when it comes to supporting your throat. Regular dairy milk can cause a buildup of phlegm on the vocal cords, so it's not great if you're a singer or someone who uses their voice a lot. I'm going to show you how to make your own homemade almond milk today, plus a sweet tea that's so delicious and very health supportive for your throat. So come and join me in the kitchen and let's get started.
Making your own almond milk is easy, affordable, and empowering because you control the ingredients. For this simple, delicious recipe, you need 1 cup of raw, plain almonds that have been soaked in water overnight. Soaking almonds for at least 8 hours unlocks healthy nutrients that are often hard for the human body to extract and digest in their raw form. This process supercharges the almonds and helps to soften them enough to create a smooth and creamy milk. Once ready to make your milk, drain the soaked almonds, discarding all of the soaking water. You will notice your almonds have expanded and become soft. This is normal. Rinse them really well to ensure any residual dirt or grit is washed away, then combine soaked almonds in a blender or food processor with fresh drinking water. If you prefer full-bodied, creamy-tasting milk, you only need to add 2 cups of water. If you prefer a thinner, more watery milk, then add 4 cups of water. The next step is to turn your blender on high to create almond milk magic. This process is always so fascinating to me because of how easy it is to create something so delicious and healthy. Once all almond pieces have been completely pulverized, pour the liquid through a piece of cheesecloth, or you can use a nut milk bag bought from any health food store or online. Gently squeeze the pulp to release the milk. You might want to do this over a medium-sized bowl to capture any leakages. Squeeze until all you have left is a small amount of almond pulp, which you can set aside to use later. Store this milk in an airtight jar in your fridge. It keeps fresh for up to 5 days and can be used as a non-dairy substitute in baking, cooking, and everything else you love to do with your regular milk of choice. I'm going to show you how to make a delicious, health-supportive sweet almond milk tea, which is one of my favorite ways to enjoy this non-dairy delight. Combine 1 cup of almond milk in a small saucepan along with 1 tablespoon of your favorite natural sweetener. I like to use raw honey, which supports the throat and vocal cords. Add 1 teaspoon of cinnamon to help stabilize blood sugar levels, along with 1 pinch of turmeric powder, a great spice to include in your diet that has many fantastic therapeutic effects. Whisking everything together to combine, it's now time to warm this tea to enjoy. If you have an immersion blender, you can use it in place of your whisk. Gently warm the tea over a medium heat and serve when it's reached your desired temperature. I also love to drink this tea chilled when it's hot outside. All you need to do is combine all of the ingredients together and place them in the fridge to chill. When you're ready, blend and serve over ice cubes to enjoy. One last tip. Remember that almond pulp we had left over from our almond milk? Don't waste it. You can use it in cereals, smoothies, even baking. All you need to do is place it on a lined baking tray in your oven to dry it out. This should only take about 10 minutes in an oven at 160 degrees. Just be sure to watch it so it doesn't burn. Store it in an airtight jar and use within 2 weeks. For the full recipes, please visit www.chrissybshow.tv. Thanks for watching. See you again soon.
So thank you very much to Danielle. Well, after the break, I'll be joined by Helena Chard for this week's Behind the Fame. Welcome back to today's programme, everyone. Now, before we go to Helena Chard for this week's Behind the Fame, I want to hear some of your opinions on how healthy a nation the UK really is. So we've been dubbed as the fat man of Europe by the NHS, but is this really fair? Well, we sent out Pax Brown to find out.
Do you believe that vitamins have healing powers?
I don't believe they have healing powers. I think they help your body in replacing some of what you haven't been able to get during the day through food and drink. So they're a supplement, but I don't think they have healing powers.
As you said, they're supplements. They replace what you don't have.
I don't think so, particularly, no.
Yeah, I do. I mean, whether you take them, you know, in a tablet form or through your food, absolutely, they do.
Do you use vitamins to boost your immune system at all?
Yes, we do, especially after a few drinks.
I don't, my kids do.
No.
I don't, my kids do.
No, I don't, no.
Sometimes, when I think I'm catching a cold, I will. I'll take some extra vitamins, but I try to eat better.
Could you mention some of the vitamins that you guys take, other than vitamin C?
Yeah, so we take vitamin C, we use vitamin E supplements for our skin, and then I use actually iron to boost my immune system because I have low iron and suffer from beta thalassemia trait.
Well, it's hard to say because I don't take any, so I don't really, it's not a very good answer, but I don't know, basically.
Like some probiotics, a multivitamin, sometimes B vitamins for stress.
Do you eat any food that has vitamins? And
sure, yeah. I mean, I have a fairly balanced diet with vegetables and I try and avoid red meat, but I have chicken and fish and so on.
Within our Indian heritage, we have a lot of food and drink that we consume that has certain healing remedies, such as turmeric, so turmeric milk, and we use fennel water. So those sorts of things we use for our children when they're feeling, you know, got a tummy ache and things like that. So yeah.
Obviously, your fruits, vegetables. I like smoothies, things that kind of, I don't eat red meat, so I have to be sure that I'm getting enough other things like tempeh or tofu, but I don't eat as many vegetables as I should, so if you can kind of cram them all in a smoothie.
How about vitamin supplements? Do you think it's wrong to take them or?
Again, I don't know because I don't use them, so I don't really hold much store by them. So I wouldn't say it's necessarily wrong, but I'm not sure that there are any great benefits from taking them.
I mean, some people may not see the benefits in using vitamins and things like that and see it as a waste of money. But at the end of the day, we do whatever we need to do to help our children and ourselves feel good. And, you know, even if it helps one iota, then absolutely it's doing something positive rather than negative.
You know, I think that they're expensive. You know, I live in Detroit, and there are a lot of kids that I'm a counselor, and I work with a lot of at-risk teens. Their diets are horrible. They don't have access to vitamins and having the luxury of buying vitamins.
Oh my God, you must eat well, healthy, lots of green vegetables, lots of chicken casserole, lots of, you know, lots of good iron and get good vegetables from vitamins from your vegetables. But you know what? If your kids don't eat the veggies, you gotta top it up just in case, because you don't want to look back in 10, 15 years' time and think, I should have done it.
Well, it's very important to take a good balanced diet with lots of vegetables and fruit to keep your system healthy.
You're gonna be old someday like me, okay? And in order to get to this age, you gotta take care of your body. Whether that's exercise, diet, vitamins, but if you start doing it now, it becomes a habit that you'll have for the rest of your life, so that you can grow old and gray or whatever hair color you end up with.
And for those people who don't eat vegetables.
So I don't think we're too bad, but thanks very much, Pax, and to the public. So now I'm delighted to be joined by Helena Chard for this week's Behind the Fame. Hello, Helena.
Hello, Chrissy.
How
Lovely
are
to
you?
Be back. Very well, thank you.
So before we start talking about Behind the Fame, should we tell the viewers about our lovely cake of the week?
I think we should.
So this lovely cake of the week has been provided by Ohe Bakery in Chelsea. So they have some stunning little cakes on offer, and I have to say this one is absolutely delicious. We've tried a little bit already, haven't
it's
we?
It's lovely.
Kind of destroyed the poor cake. But Helena's going to be
royal.
Trying a bit more later on and
Wonderful
telling you guys
chips.
How it is. So, Helena, tell us all about
so
what you have for us
we're
today.
We're going to start, so, oh, we, when we speak about celebrity, but we also speak about the ordinary person that does lovely things.
Yes.
Because that's all very inspirational to everybody. Mm-hmm. So, you speak about a lovely guy called Anderson Boyce. Mm-hmm. He lives in Romford and he has his own salon, Hair Force One.
Yes.
Really lovely deed, very simple, and it's something I think that could roll out. But let me start by saying what he does. So he offers haircuts to young men 18 to 24. He's had a very successful career, which he built up. He struggled, but now he does really well. And he remembers the times where he fought to get to interviews and things like that. So he offers free haircuts to guys going to interviews.
Oh, that's lovely. Yeah.
Obviously, they have to be going to interviews, not just coming for free haircuts.
Yes.
And, but he also gives them pep talks as well, so to build up self-confidence. And I think it's really lovely. I mean, he works with the YMCA and also the local job centre there.
Yeah.
And I could just see it. Actually, salons are a great place. You could roll out lots of different things, couldn't you?
Yeah,
which is really lovely. So good for Anderson Boyce.
Well done.
Mm. Also something like, so don't keep quiet and carry on, says Kate, William and Harry. So it's their mental health plea. Mm. But you remember the thing from Second World War.
Mm-hmm.
So they've been talking about their Heads Together, which is the charity, which Virgin Money London Marathon is supporting, the main charity. And it's been interesting listening to them sort of release little bits about themselves.
Yeah.
And Prince William especially as well, talking about how it's their ambition for millions of conversations to develop about mental health in 2017. For everyone to talk out, and obviously it's life-changing to talk out and really helpful, as we know. So fantastic, and obviously the marathon's in April and there's lots of different
Are
we'll
you
be talking
be
about I'm not going to be about running, but I might
especially not on eating this cake every week on the section.
I would like to do it at some point.
Really? I couldn't.
Maybe we should just throw ourselves into it.
The Chrissy B, yeah, should do it.
Yeah.
I'm walking, not running.
Well, yeah, it's about doing it, isn't it?
Yes.
And raising money and things. So that's really lovely. And I think also really lovely to hear Prince William and Prince Harry talk about... I was quite surprised, actually. So Prince William was really, really, really very angry when his mother died, Princess Diana, obviously. And Prince Harry didn't talk about it for 16 years. So also
so
by them
lot,
talking
yeah,
about yeah. it and talking to everybody and getting everyone to talk for them as well, keeping it quiet and private. I'm quite shocked that they didn't have people to talk to, but it was obviously their decision. And
I suppose
they were quite
being
young.
So much in the public eye as well, it was difficult, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, all eyes were on them after
definitely.
Their mum died.
And I mean, it was... William was 15 and Harry 12, yeah. So. But now they're older, and they've also come to a place as well that it's the 20th anniversary of their mother's death.
Yes.
And they want something special to be a memorial, mm-hmm. is that right?
Yes. Yeah,
of their mother, yeah. To be at Kensington Palace, which is really, really lovely. So they're going to choose somebody to do a sculpture, which yeah. would be great, because there hasn't been anything that special, I
know
think.
What we have
they
in
had
Hyde
like a
Park,
water
but
feature,
it's not
but it's
very...
not really personal.
I expected something a bit more than that, to
yeah,
be honest.
Yeah, I think so. It's yeah. good what they're doing. They're of an age and they want something for their mum. They want something for everybody to visit and obviously to reflect upon her and her legacy. And so that would be really special. I look forward to that.
Yeah.
I think it's gonna come up six with. People, I think, are going to choose who the sculptress or sculptor will be. So that should be fun.
Yeah.
Also, which is something quite exciting, if you love Idris Elba, who is a very yummy British actor, so you can win a date on Valentine's Day with him. You have to enter a lottery for it.
I haven't done it.
I think I might. But it's a very funny video actually. If you watch it, he's really very good. Actually, he'd make a great James Bond. He would make a very good James Bond. But anyway, moving on. So he is raising money for We Can Lead. It's an initiative to help girls across Africa with everything from, you know, it's basically empowering, education, and girls obviously eventually becoming decision makers and, you know, people quite high up in business.
Yeah.
Hopefully, which will be really good. So it's a leadership opportunity, and of course mentoring and things that.
Which we talk about on the show, don't we?
Yeah, all the time. Mm-hmm. So that's really exciting, and I just think it's just a funny idea.
So you win a date, and what happens?
Actually, on Valentine's Day as well.
Okay.
So you have a nice meal, you have a nice overnight, not necessarily with Idris Elba, but you know the whole special thing.
Right.
But I think it's quite exciting. It's all about giving money, and I think you can actually bid as well for different merchandise. With him on t-shirts. And
he's quite brave to do that, I think.
He is, but I think
it
will be, you know.
Yeah, obviously, yeah.
Well, it's quite funny.
Bodyguards everywhere and like following you around.
Yeah.
Also,
something I didn't know about is a young lady called Gabby Douglas. She's 20, but she, Olympic gold gymnast, so incredibly amazing. She was at Rio, but she was targeted by cyberbullies and just online media trolls and horrible. And she'd never had this done to her before, and she was actually at the Olympics. People were sort of picking on her about her hair, her expressions.
Yeah.
She didn't put her hand on her heart when singing, you know, the anthem or whatever that is. Yeah, the anthem. And she was incredibly upset, and she realised that she wanted to do something to try and help other people. And she's just been doing programmes and sort of saying to especially youngsters not to take it personally and to speak out.
Mm.
But she was really down about it. I mean, it's horrible, isn't it, when you're achieving so much.
Yeah.
And for no reason at all.
It happens, and there's those people out there that just want to put you down.
Which is such a shame. Mm. But there was also Love for Gabby USA, which was a hashtag that flew out because everyone realised that she was being picked on and everything. But she set up something very sweet, which is a hackharassment.com, and it's a pledge. I'm not too sure how it will work, but it's quite a sweet thought that everyone has to go on and just sign that they won't be nasty.
Oh.
You know, and once you do that, you pledge that you're not going to be nasty, and you never do it. So it's something quite simple. But horrible, these cyberbullies.
Yes.
Not good at all. Moving on, Russell Brand has launched a new employment service for ex-offenders and recovering addicts, which is really good. A lot of the people there as well are recovering ex-addicts, so they get to meet people coming in. And one thing that he said was when people work together, they can sort of connect and they can overcome it together, which is just something
that's
very
nice.
Simple.
Yeah.
That's really
I mean, it
lovely.
Does help sometimes when you're doing something with someone else, don't you? It's like when you have an exercise buddy or something.
And the camaraderie, it sort of keeps you going, doesn't it?
It does.
It's fabulous. And something that I thought was really sweet, just very simple. So Mary Berry, who's obviously the cook and makes lovely cakes as well, She has won.
Make a cake for us?
I know, wouldn't it be lovely? I think we should, we need to ask. So she was crowned best TV judge at the National TV Awards, which was really quite special. I don't know if you saw it,
no,
but she was so surprised to win. And it's so lovely to think she's 81 as well. Oh. And it was just a beautiful little thing. And the thing about the Great Bake Off, which obviously is moving channel, mm-hmm. it's something for everyone. So children love her. It's a great family entertainment show, isn't it?
Yeah,
and we all know that getting families together is just the best thing.
Yeah, it's a difficult thing, but... Yeah.
And I think something special about her as well, she got polio at the age of 13. So it affected her spine and her hands and everything. But it actually gave her, the illness toughened her up and taught her sort of to make the most of every opportunity which she finds, which is something very special.
See, no matter your age, you can always achieve something, can't you?
Absolutely.
Age is not a reason to give up on life or just to keep quiet and not achieve anything, is it? Keep going.
Cake time.
All right, so... Because Helena, you can try the cake. I've already tried the look. I have to say, we're trying to cut it before. It did get a little bit messy, unfortunately, but that was our cutting skills, not the cake.
So I love the lovely gold bits on it. It's very regal.
It's very beautiful.
Royal.
Okay, so as I said, this... I've forgotten the bakery.
Okay.
Mm. Bakery. And if you have a bakery or a shop and you would like to feature one of your cakes or muffins or whatever it is that you do on this programme for our Cake of the Week segment with Behind the Fame and Helena Chard, you can... Is that good?
Please, we want them to come in each week.
You can email us on info@chrissybshow.tv. Well, we have reached the end of this segment. Helena, thank you so much. Do enjoy the cake, which our other guests will be trying again later on. And do stay tuned, because after the break, I'll be joined by Dr. Rob Hicks. He'll be answering all of your medical questions. So don't go away. Hi, I'm Chrissy B, and my show is all about improving your mental health and being happy. Join me every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 10 p.m. on my channel, Sky 203. Visit chrissybshow.tv for more information and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Chrissy B Show. You can also follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Chrissy B Show and on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show. Welcome back to The Chrissy B Show, everyone. Now, as you know, we do focus on this program on mental health, but we also do talk about physical health because the two are very closely linked. So today I'm joined by Dr. Rob Hicks for this week's Doctor's Answers. And if you want to get your questions in, you can email us on info@chrissybshow.tv. You can ask any question whatsoever. We're not going to read out any names, so do please feel free to ask anything. So Rob, how are you?
Very well, thank you.
Welcome to the show.
Lovely to be back, as always.
You've been eating a bit of our cake of the week, confess.
I have. It's not a confession. I think every little thing in moderation helps.
Yes, but you're going to have some more on.
A little bit of what you fancy does you good.
Yes, indeed. And you're going to have some more on.
I'm going to have as much as available.
Okay. That's if our producer hasn't eaten the rest of it. Okay, so let's go through some of the questions that we've got here. So, hi, Rob. The other day, I fell really hard on my shoulder and it popped out of its socket. Ow. A friend of mine got it back in. It's a bit worrying, isn't it? But I'm a bit worried about it as it still hurts, but only a bit. It's more uncomfortable than pain. Do I need to go to the doctor or is this normal?
Well, if you've dislocated your shoulder and you're in pain, there's a message there that, yes, you need to have it checked out. So, yes, you do need to go and have it checked out, because the problem with a dislocated shoulder, even if it's been put back in...
Is that
you may well have suffered a fracture somewhere within the shoulder joint or the upper part of the humerus, the upper arm bone. Or you may well have torn ligaments or tendons as well. And this is a particularly common problem, the tearing is, when somebody who's not professionally trained tries to put the shoulder joint back together again. So you mustn't criticise your friend for trying to help you, but if it should happen again, and for anybody else watching, for whom it happens, if you do dislocate your shoulder, make sure that you get yourself to the accident and emergency department of your local hospital, where somebody, a trained orthopaedic surgeon can put it back into place for you. Because the risk of the dislocation, and indeed trying to put it back yourself, is that you may damage blood vessels, you may damage nerves, you may actually damage the tendons and ligaments. So simple answer is yes, go and get it checked out.
Okay. Right, next question. I'm a woman, I'm only 22, but I have pretty bad hemorrhoids. I've tried treating them with over-the-counter medications, but I'd rather be completely rid of them. What are my options?
Okay, well, the other common name for hemorrhoids is piles, and these are the swollen blood vessels in and around the back passage, and they're not very comfortable for most people. They tend to itch, and they can indeed bleed sometimes. It's really good that you've gone to the pharmacist and asked for some over-the-counter remedies to start with, because that's a good starting point. And the advice that I would give you is, if you haven't started this already, is to change your diet a little bit. So, you know, increase the amount of fibre, drink more liquid. And the idea behind that is to avoid any constipation or straining when you go to the toilet, which is going to make the piles worse or make them reappear once they've disappeared. Mm. Your doctor may prescribe a steroid cream. They may prescribe some painkillers if they're uncomfortable, or indeed a mild laxative, again, to soften the motions so that you're not having to strain to open your bowels when you go to the toilet, because, of course, that makes the hemorrhoids worse. To get rid of them totally, if the over-the-counter treatments and the treatments that your doctor may suggest are not working, well, they can be treated with minor surgery. So you can have them injected, you can have bands put around the bottom of the hemorrhoid, or you can have electric currents used. Ooh. And what that does is it reduces the blood supply to the hemorrhoid, and helps it to shrink, and then it disappears. For some people, they do have to have them surgically removed, but usually that's a last resort, because for the most part, all the other measures do help.
Okay, thank you for that. Next question. This person says, hello, Chrissy B. Last summer, I went travelling in South America. Afterwards, I began having severe digestive troubles, and now I'm pretty sure I picked up some parasites down there. What's the best way to get rid of intestinal parasites? I have no idea, I'm afraid, but this question is going to go over to Dr. Rob Hicks.
Thank you, Chris, for that. Great deflection. The first thing to do is to have a checkup with your doctor and get a stool sample tested to see actually whether you've got a bowel infection or indeed a parasite infection. If that's the case, then there are medicines that can be taken to get rid of it. I think the other thing to think about is that after a gut infection, some people develop IBS, irritable bowel syndrome, and it might be that your digestive symptoms are related to that rather than to an active infection. The other thing is, it could be pure coincidence that you've developed a gut condition that's nothing to do with the travel where you went, nothing to do with parasites. And this is why it's important, really, to have a full checkup with your doctor. So he or she can ask you lots of questions about your symptoms. He or she can examine you and run any necessary stool tests or indeed blood tests as well, to try and get to the root of the problem. And then you can be offered the best treatment to overcome it.
Okay, thank you. Next question. Apparently, I have a very low bone density measurement. I'm 36 and my doctors are already worried. What changes should I make to my diet to up my bone density?
Well, this is a very relevant question, because
yes,
we were talking about vitamin D and osteoporosis, you know, thinning of the bones earlier on in the programme. Yes, your doctor's right to be concerned, because, you know, you are young for this condition, and therefore, you know, you're right to ask questions about what you can do to improve your lifestyle, really. Calcium is obviously very, very important. You get calcium from dairy products. You also get it from green leafy vegetables, and you get it, you know, in some foods that are fortified as well. As you've heard earlier on in our programme, for calcium to be absorbed effectively, we also need vitamin D. So we make that in the skin in response to sunlight. We can also get that from sun foods. So, for example, oily fish. We can also get it from fortified foods. We get it in tofu as well. And there are also supplements, as we were talking about earlier, of vitamin D. So have a chat with your doctor as to whether you need to not just look at your diet for calcium and vitamin D, but also whether you need to have a calcium and vitamin D supplement as well. The other thing is exercise. Weight-bearing exercise and resistance exercise, very, very good for generating strong, healthy bones and actually increasing the bone density. And the other thing, of course, is not to smoke. Smoking, you know, increases the risk of thin bones, which you already have, so you certainly don't want to be doing that. The National Osteoporosis Society have a lot of good information, so you might want to give them a call or go onto their website and see what other information you can find to help strengthen your bones.
Okay. Now, next question, Rob. What causes veins to burst? Every few months, a vein bursts in one of my feet and it gets swollen and purple. It usually subsides within a few days, but I'm still worried it's a sign I'm doing something wrong. Am I maybe exercising too hard?
Well, the answer to this question is it's often trauma that causes this problem. And what you're describing sounds to me like a bruise. And what you're saying is that you don't remember, my interpretation of what you're saying, you don't remember injuring yourself.
It's like me.
So therefore, yeah. You know, you're not associating it with a bruise, because normally we know, you know, we hit our arm, we hit our leg, a bruise forms, and we know. But it sounds to me like, you know, maybe through exercising too hard, maybe through the shoes that you're wearing, maybe from other activities that involve your feet, that actually this minor trauma is happening, because what you're describing is very much sounds like a bruise. If it's happening on a regular basis, so more often than the months you're saying, and if it's happening in other parts of your body, or you have other symptoms, so for example, nosebleeds that you can't understand why you're getting, then have a checkup with your doctor. Mm-hmm.
This is the last question for today, Rob. I'm nearsighted and work in front of a computer for nearly 7 hours a day. After looking to a monitor for so long, my eyes get fatigued and become dry by the end of the day. I'm afraid that working on a computer will deteriorate my eyesight and force me to get more powerful eyeglass prescriptions. Is there anything else I can do?
It is each and every one of us now is spending an increasing amount of time in front of a computer screen. And isn't it interesting how the question has actually given us the answer? Uh-huh. I am spending increasing amounts of time, 7 hours, at the end my eyes are tired. Mm-hmm. It doesn't actually take us a doctor to come up with a solution. Your solution is to take screen breaks. That's going to be the solution for you. And we work on the 20-20-20 principle. So ideally, every 20 minutes, take 20 seconds to look about 20 feet away from your screen, and you know, in another direction, and that will rest your eyes. The other thing that happens when we're using a computer screen is we don't blink as much, so the eyes become very dry. So you might have to consciously think about blinking more frequently while you're using the screen or during the rest breaks. And also, you can get artificial tears from the pharmacist to use to actually moisten the eyes and to stop them from being so dry. I would say to you that you should have your eyes tested just to make sure that you don't need a stronger prescription. But generally speaking, for the most part, using a computer screen is not going to deteriorate your eyesight. Mm. But it is, as you're finding out, going to make your eyes feel very tired and make them feel dry and uncomfortable. So if you can get into the habit of taking those screen breaks, I think you will find a huge amount of benefit.
Rob, just a question on that as well. Would it be the same effect as looking at your phone for so long as well? Is it just...
I think that answer is true, mm-hmm. but we don't look at our phone generally for that long, constant periods of time. They're shorter periods of time, unless you're watching a movie on your phone. Mm. But I think, you know, the way that we use these devices, I think only in time we'll find out. But if you're using a phone a lot and you're getting tired eyes...
Yeah,
and dry eyes, then the message is the same, you know, take screen breaks.
Okay, brilliant advice. Thank you so much, Dr. Rob Hicks.
My pleasure.
For your amazing answers.
I'm off for cake now.
Yes, he's going to have some cake. A little bit of everything, as he said.
Absolutely.
And don't forget, if you do have a question for Rob, you can email us on info@chrissybshow.tv. Well, don't go away, because after the break, I'll be talking to Director of Ekko Cleaning Service, Dilyana Asenova, for handy hints and tips to clean your home. And I'll be giving you my top 5 ways to declutter your mind. Welcome back to the Chrissy B Show, everyone. Now, on this part of the program, we like to look at different ways you can make your life that little bit easier and manageable. So it doesn't need to be much. Sometimes it's just a small lifestyle change that can make the world of difference to your everyday health. Now, a study by a Scottish health survey revealed that carrying out regular, vigorous housework can cut feelings of anxiety and stress by up to 20%. But cleaning doesn't always need to be a chore. So here to discuss the benefits of cleaning and to give us some top tips is the Director of Ekko Cleaning Service, Dilyana Asenova. Hello, Dilyana.
Hi, Chrissy.
Nice to have you on the program. So we're not going to be talking about any sort of cleaning. We're going to be talking about green cleaning. Can you explain what that is, please?
Green cleaning aims to reduce the damage caused to the environment by replacing chemical products like chlorine and bleaches by absolutely natural alternatives.
Okay, because obviously it's not good for us to be breathing all those... I mean, I use things with chemicals because sometimes I think that maybe the natural stuff wouldn't be as good, but you're going to be telling us about that in just a moment. But why is it so therapeutic to clean, would you say?
It's therapeutic because brings you some more exercise and help you burn calories and help you beating your depression and stress. Mm-hmm. Help you just blow off the steam.
Yeah, while you're hoovering or like or something.
And also cleaning from top to bottom your house help you prevent allergies and protect your immune system as well.
See, so it's not just, you know, something that we have to do. It's something that actually is good for us.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, so you have three things here for us, Dilyana, that you're going to be explaining what each one is and how we can use it and what around the house to really benefit. So what's the first one?
The first one is baking soda. It's actually three products that I think every housewife or every person has in her home. Mm-hmm. Okay, we have baking soda, lemons and vinegar.
Okay. Any sort of vinegar, is it? Or
it's wine vinegar.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So tell us about, you're going to tell us about the baking soda first then.
Yeah, baking soda, even I'm going to demonstrate you with this silver bracelet.
Okay.
Baking soda is very good for polished silver.
Okay.
Yeah. Now I'm just going to put it inside.
Okay. Wet it first. So we're rubbing the baking soda on.
Yeah, rubbing on the baking soda.
Oh, wow.
It's becoming
really
very
off.
Shiny and clean.
Let's have a look. Wow, look at that compared to, I don't know if we can catch that on camera. Can you see the bottom half compared to the top already? You've only just started doing it.
So
you don't need to use a cloth or anything. You just literally just rub it with your fingers.
Yeah, exactly. Very good.
Wow.
You can see the difference.
Look at the shine.
Yeah.
Let's hold that for the viewers to see. Can you see that, guys? Wow, that's really good.
Yeah, I think now is the time to say that if you have some golden jewelry, the ketchup is very good polisher.
For gold, really?
Absolutely, yes.
Oh, wow. But how do you just rub it on as well?
Yeah. You take a microfiber cloth and you rub it. You put the ketchup.
I didn't know that. Wow.
This tomato sauce is very good for polishing golden.
Oh, wow. Okay, I'm going to try that.
Or you should.
Okay, so what else can we use baking soda for?
You can eliminate outdoor smells, or if your fridge smells really bad, you just take a bowl with water, put baking soda inside, put it in the fridge, and no more
odors.
Yeah.
Okay. Any more tricks, Dilyana, with the baking soda?
If you want to unclog your drain.
Baking soda, really? For drains?
Yeah, 1 cup baking soda, put it in the drain, and after that, 1 cup vinegar. It's perfect.
And you're telling me that's going to be even like just as good as using those heavy duty.
Absolutely, yes.
Wow. Okay, I've got to try that to see. Okay.
Yeah,
and
it's good.
How about the lemons? What would you use the lemons for?
Lemons is very good for if you put like 2 spoons of lemons and 4 spoons of olive oil. It's very good for polishing any wooden furniture in the house.
Wow. So hang on, doesn't it make the olive oil make it all sort of sticky and...
No, it's perfect. It makes it polished like when you use like cleaning product for wooden.
Uh-huh.
It's the same effect.
Okay.
It's perfect.
Okay, and how about the vinegar? What would you use that for?
Vinegar is the best lime scale remover.
Really?
Absolutely, yes. It's very good for lime scale. If you have a lot of lime scale, use vinegar. Also, it's very good for polishing windows, mirrors, glasses.
So all this stuff is really interesting, but it's just, sometimes it's just hard to sort of believe, I suppose, until you try that these kind of things, the natural things, are just as effective as the things that we normally buy in the supermarket, the brands.
Yeah, these products are more effective, more cheaper, and you don't breathe any chemicals, strong chemicals.
Yeah.
It's much more healthier for you and for your family.
Oh, yeah. Okay, we've got to try it, guys. So I don't know if you guys want to try these things out at home and let us know how you get on. You can email us on info@chrissybshow.tv. And if you have your own cleaning tips, maybe you use some other natural products for cleaning at home, do let us know about them. We'd love to hear. Thank you so much, Dilyana.
Thank you so much for
helping. All right, guys, so don't go away, because now I'm going to be speaking about 5 ways to declutter your mind. All right, guys, so we've spoken about cleaning, which was really enlightening, and now I'm going to be talking about 5 ways to declutter your mind. So the first point is To declutter physically. So I remember speaking about this maybe before Christmas. Physical clutter actually leads to mental clutter. So when you have lots and lots of things around you, there are so many things that will stimulate your brain, and your brain will actually get very tired. So I personally find it really difficult to work or concentrate if there's any mess around me. So I normally have to start cleaning up before anything else. So start decluttering, and don't just do it once. Make this like a regular thing so that mess doesn't actually build up in the first place. And trust me, the less stuff that you have, the easier things are to maintain, and the freer you're going to feel in your mind as well. My second point is to store elsewhere. So I'm always going on about the benefits of writing things down, and I would never be able to keep everything stored in my brain because there's just so many things that I have to do. So find out what works best for you, but it could be maybe a diary, or it could be an app that you have on your phone. But if it's an app, make sure that you can actually back it up somewhere, because you don't want to lose all your information. And then you can actually write down all the things that you need to do. So you can write all your appointments, your reminders, all those things that, you know, you just can't forget. And you don't need to keep everything stored in your brain. Like maybe you have some ideas, you have some personal things that you need to sort out. You can actually store all of this and write this all down so that, you know, if you do tend to happen to forget something, you're not going to panic. You can actually just refer to your phone or refer to your diary. And also, you can even list down some things from the past that you maybe have been dragging you down, and write down how you're going to deal with them and start ticking things off as you go along. And even if you've not dealt with everything, the important thing is that you've actually got it noted somewhere and that you are working towards this. And this alone actually gives you a boost. When you've actually got lots of things to sort out and you're trying to do it all in your head, work, problems, things that you need to change, all these kind of things, it's all there in your brain, you will feel overwhelmed. But as you start writing things down, make your list, tick things off, you'll feel a lot better. Even if you're not going to deal with that thing there and then at that moment, but the fact that it's written down, it's noted, you're going to deal with it, that already is a big thing off your brain. Let's go to my third point. There's no such thing as multitasking. So I used to think I was really good at multitasking. That was until I learned something really interesting on my own show. I think it might have been some research that we did, or from a guest. And it was actually said that no one really ever multitasks, and only one thing can have your full attention at a time. So you may indeed be able to do different things at the same time, such as ironing and watching TV, but both of those things won't be getting your full attention, and one of them will lack in quality, or both actually. So try to work on one thing at a time until it gets done. So for example, if you're working on a report, don't keep stopping to answer emails. Dedicate maybe an hour, for example, an hour to the report, and say to yourself that you won't stop until that hour is up. Then you can dedicate some time to answering emails. And trust me, you get so much more done and your brain doesn't get as tired. I was making this mistake. I was trying to do lots of things at once. And as soon as I started dedicating my full attention to one thing at a time, things got done quicker, things got done better, and I wasn't so tired. My fourth point is, don't overload. So sometimes the issue with a cluttered mind is due to way too much coming in the first place. So nowadays we have access to so much information, don't we? So we not only have newspapers and TV like we did in the past, but now we have access to a lot more through the internet and social media. And you can get so drawn in and you don't actually realize that you're overloading your brain. So too much information does clog up the brain. So you can do this by maybe setting time limits on how long you spend on social media sites, or maybe you're the type of person that is literally checking your social media every few minutes. I mean, to be honest, sometimes when I'm sort of just looking around at other people, they just don't seem to come off at all. They're just there, even when they're walking in the street, crossing the road, just looking at their phone all the time. So do try to discipline yourself, and try, if you can, to just maybe check a few times a day. You'd probably be surprised how often you're checking, actually. Maybe you can do your own little experiment to see. And you can also cancel some notifications and pop-ups, which are all there just to draw you in. And, you know, I've taken notifications off my phone. I find them really distracting, and it does really help to keep my mind a bit more free. Now for my fifth point, which is to put systems in place. So try to decide on as many small things as possible so that there are less things to think about. So something that I'm planning to do, for example, which I haven't done yet, but I am planning to do it, is how I plan outfits for this show. So I noticed that I waste a lot of time and brain space trying to decide what I'm going to wear for each program. And so what I've decided to do is actually work out maybe a month's worth of outfits, write it down somewhere or take pictures of it, and then I won't have to think about it on that show. I won't have to think about, you know, just once in the month I'm going to have to think about the outfits. So you can do this with absolutely anything, maybe different things that maybe take up your mind space, such as what you're going to have for dinner, the day you do your laundry and housework and so on. Just plan it before and it will be a lot easier. Well, guys, we have reached the end of today's program, but don't forget, if you have something that you would like to share on this show, maybe you have an inspiring story, or maybe there's something that you would like to see covered on this program, please, please do get in touch with us. We love to hear from our viewers. You can email us on info@chrissybshow.tv. You can also tweet us @chrissybshow. You can leave a message on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show, and you can also send a message on Instagram, which is also Chrissy B Show. And if you'd like to know more about me and my struggles in the past and how I overcame everything, you can go to my personal website, which is mylifeafterdepression.com. Until next time, bye-bye for now. If you're low on vitamin D, we'll also hear... Oh, sorry. Oh, no! Got to do the whole thing again. Well, everyone, as well as taking your vitamin D supplements, you can also top that all up. Oh, goodness, start again. So it doesn't need to be much. Sometimes it's just a small lifestyle change. That said, that no one really ever multitasks, and only one thing, I'll do that bit again.